Amen. Good morning, Liberty. Merry Christmas. Man, it is so good to see everyone out. I guess if you couldn't tell already, today is a special day. We're celebrating, of course, the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ today. But also, here in a little while, we'll be taking in a Holy Communion, remembering what Jesus done for us. Without the birth, there couldn't have been the life. There couldn't have been the death. So today we're celebrating the life of Jesus today. But I'm so glad that you're here with us. I want to say, if you're here with us and you're a first-time guest with us today, we are so glad you're here with us. If you'll look in the pew in front of you, there's a Connect card. If you'll take that card sometime today and fill it out, take it out to our table after the service, we got just a small gift just to say thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us today. So if you're a first time with us, please do that. Just a couple announcements I want to shoot out, because this is the only commercial we're going to have today. And then we're just jumping right in. We're going to go and we're just going to worship Jesus for a little while. I just want to mention, I haven't mentioned this yet, a few of you on Facebook, we're planning on taking a team this summer to Roatan, Honduras. Me and my family, we're going down with a few weeks, and we're opening it up. If anybody's interested from Liberty, we'd love to take a team with us from Liberty. We're planning on the dates will be June the 25th through July the 2nd, the week we'll be going. We're actually going to stay for 2 weeks. But that's the week we're planning on taking a team. If anyone's interested in going, the cost is usually $1,300 to $1,500, just depending on airfare to get us down there. So if that's something you're interested in, just see me sometime this week. Call me, send me an email, hit us up on Facebook if you're interested, and we can give you more details on stuff and when the first deposit and everything's due. Also, I want to mention a couple things that I'm really excited about that's going to happen in the next couple weeks that I really want everybody to get excited about. Next week, if you can be here next week, and tell everybody else if you can be here, I want to beg you to be here next week. Next week, I'm going to be casting some vision for next year on where we're going, what we're going to do. And we're going to start something next Sunday that I'm not going to spoil it because you got to be here to see. But it's really excited about, and I believe it's going to affect your families, and it's going to affect our community if you'll be here next Sunday. I'm just excited about it. Then the following Sunday, January the 3rd, we're going to jump into the 21-day Daniel fast. If you have never been part of a 21-day Daniel fast, let me tell you, it will change your life if you take it seriously. But like I was telling some other people the other day, it's all about what you put in it. It's what you're going to get out of it. Now, if you just go to eat beans and fruits for 21 days, you're just doing a diet. But if you really go into it seeking God, I promise you, he tells us if you'll seek him, you'll find him. But I do want to tell you, if that's something that you think you want, I would love for our whole church, we're doing it corporately. If that's something, if you've got physical abilities, disabilities, I would ask you to be consulting your physician to ask him what you can partake of, what you can't, because we don't want anyone to do something that would danger their health. So be checking in that next couple weeks. We'll start that the first Sunday in January after service. So eat you a good breakfast that Sunday morning. And then come, and we'll kick it off that Sunday. And we got, like I said, and I'll talk more about that next week. So those are just a couple things. Next couple weeks, I'm excited with things that's going on. So I hope you get excited about it, because I'm really excited about it. And just looking forward to next year and what God's going to do with Liberty Baptist Church next year. Well, during this time, I want to ask our ushers, Phil, come. We're going to get prepared to give back where the Lord has blessed us this week, this morning, and just pray over our service. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for loving us. We thank you that this time of year we get to celebrate, Lord, the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus. God, I just pray that, Lord, I know this time of year can get really busy, Lord, and we can get focused on gifts and parties and just everything else that's going on. But Father, I pray that as we go into the week that we celebrate your birth, that today would be a special day in our lives, where we just take this moment and set it aside and say, God, I just want to focus on you for a minute. I just want to thank you. We just want to just celebrate you and worship you today. God, I pray that we worship you in spirit and truth. God, I pray if there's one here that is lost and they've never been saved by your amazing grace, may today be their day of salvation. Father, I pray, God, that you'd speak to us through the songs today. But God, I pray that we just wouldn't stand here and listen to words, but we would lift our voices, lift our hands, and lift everything in us and worship you today. Father, take this offering. May we use it to upbuild your kingdom. And may you get all the glory. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship together, church.
If you'll stand with us as we sing.
Your love is like radiant diamonds bursting inside us, we cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfires, singing your name, God of mercy. Your love is like radiant diamonds bursting inside us, we cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfire. cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfires, singing your
far away, rising. Thank you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name. Sing that again. Praise Your name this morning. Lord, we just want to keep our eyes on You, keep You fixed in the center of this service, God. Holy Spirit, lead us and guide us and direct us as we continue to worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated this morning. Wow, what a powerful time of worship. Does anybody agree with me on that? Hallelujah. It's good when we get together and just sing praises. Man, it's really good when God shows up and comes amongst us. Amen. And I'm just expecting Him. He's not leaving. I'm expecting Him just to keep moving. And He's going to do something great here in just a moment. As I was preparing for this week, God kind of gave me an unusual, I think it's an unusual sermon for Christmas. You may not, but we'll see as we go along. But I think God's got a word for somebody today. Anybody in here ever had a rough day? Anybody here say, oh yeah, I've had a rough day, preacher? I would say probably all of us could raise your hand. Anybody ever had a rough week? For the whole week, it was just like, whoo, Lord have mercy, how am I going to make it through this? Anybody maybe ever had a rough month? Yeah. Oh my goodness, yeah. How about this? How about a rough year? Yeah. Anybody ever been through one of those when you was just waiting on, you just praise God, 2016's coming. Amen. Are you ready to put 2015 behind us? Well, thanks so much. Have you ever heard anybody just say, man, I've had a rough life? It's been a rough life. You may be one of those who said, man, I've just had a rough life. It's been a rough life. And as I got to thinking about, and this week as I was looking into, you know, really looking into the Christmas story, the story about Jesus' birth, it just hit me. You know, when we think about a rough life in the Bible, a lot of us would probably think about Job. We probably think about Job. Job had a pretty rough life. Well, but Job's whole life wasn't rough. It was just one section of Job's life that really got really rough. But I got to thinking about it, and I'd never seen it until this week. And today we're going to look at the roughest life that's ever been lived. And it's right here in the Scriptures. And it begins in Luke chapter 2. So if you got your Bibles, we're going to be in Luke chapter 2. And we're going to begin reading in verse 1, and we're going to read through 7. Last week we covered 8 through 20. Well, today we're going to back up and we're going to cover verses 1 through 7. If you don't have your Bibles with you, the verses will be on the screen for you as we read together. So let's read together as we begin in verse number 1. And the Bible says, "And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. The census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, every one to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was out of the house and the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was, while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." With the Lord's help today, I want to preach a message titled, "The Rough Life." The Rough Life. Let's pray together. Father, we love You. God, I just pray that this morning, in just these few minutes that we have together, God, that You would speak to our hearts. God, that You would reveal Yourself to us. God, I pray, Lord, if there's one here that is lost, that today, Lord, they would realize that you sent your son and he lived and he died just for them. Father, may your spirit have freedom today. Move amongst your people. And we ask this in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. And you may be thinking, the roughest life, and we're starting in Luke chapter 2. Well, that's a story about Jesus. And I got to thinking about the life of Jesus, and we're just going to kind of run through the life of Jesus this morning. Jesus lived the roughest life, what we consider rough now. I'm talking about what we would consider a rough life. Lived the roughest life anybody has ever lived. Let's look at it. Well, first of all, we see when he was born, it tells us right here in our scriptures that he was born, they wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and they laid him in a manger. Now, a lot of us, we really like to picture Jesus' manger, just as we see in the Christmas lights when we're riding by, you know, a pretty little shed with a little basket, and here's the cows, you know, laying nicely over here, and the sheep are all placed in their place. That's the way we like to picture the manger scene, right? That's the way we like to picture it, because that's just, oh, it's beautiful. I want to tell you, it was not beautiful. Most of the time where a manger would be under the house. It would go around back in the hillside, and it would be under the house for one purpose. So all the manure from the animals and all the steam that come out from the manure would help heat the house. So this is where Jesus is being born, in a manure, pretty much a stable that's a pile of manure to help heat the house. There's probably an old dirty trough sitting there that there's animal slobber, everything else in, and this is where Mary gives birth. I know your mother's in here that's went through giving birth. I know you couldn't never even imagine giving birth to your child in a place like this. But this is where the Son of God was born, in a filthy manure field. I'm sure it didn't smell very well either. Anybody ever worked in the chicken house business? Yeah, it kind of smells a little bit in there, right? I've worked on a hog farm. Anybody ever worked on a hog farm? I've worked on a hog farm. It don't smell too good. I can imagine all this, and this is how Jesus started his life. This is how he came. Started pretty rough, wouldn't you say? Rough life as a baby coming into the world. But he come as that, to come humbly. He didn't come laying him in a big golden trough somewhere. He came humble, and he came for me and you. So his life started rough. Well, secondly, let's jump on into the teen years. I know what you're saying, well, you ain't got no scripture for that. I don't, but I got some scripture, I think, because I got to thinking about it. We don't know much about Jesus' teen life. It wasn't wrote about in the scripture. But I got to thinking, this is the one scripture that came to my mind. In Hebrews 4:15, this is what the Bible says. For we do not have a high priest. Now, this is talking of Jesus. We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all ways tempted as we are, yet without sin. That one verse tells me that Jesus, all the way through his childhood, all the way through his teenage years, he was tempted just like every other teenage boy was tempted. Everything that was put in front of him, he was tempted to do it. He was tempted to go along with the crowd. He was tempted to be just like everybody else. But the Bible said he did not sin any in his whole life. So that tells me that through his teen years, with all the peer pressure, with all the people wanting him to come do this, he stood strong. And he did not do it. Let me ask you this, a lot of my teenagers are right here, and I know there's more over the building. What would happen if you really stood for your faith and you said no to all the stuff that's fun to your buddies that's hanging out, all the stuff that's fun, all the stuff that everybody else is doing that they want you to do because that's what you got to do to fit in. If you said no to all of it, you probably wouldn't fit in, right? I thought about Jesus through his whole teenage years. He was tempted like everybody else, but he said no. He was tempted to come over here. I can just see him as one of the outcasts, as a teenager. Nobody wanted to hang out with Jesus. Jesus thinks he's better than everybody else. Nobody wants to be around Jesus. I can just see Jesus probably just hanging out, working in his wood shop with Joseph, and he sees the guys running down there, fixing to go do something, play ball or something, and he wants to go out with them, and all of a sudden, have you ever seen this? You see it in the movies where the one little kid that nobody else wants to be around, they see him coming, and everybody else is like, there he comes. Y'all go, 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 go. Get away from him. I think that's the way Jesus probably through his teenage years went. He had a rough teenage life. But let me tell you guys, Jesus did it so he could set the example for each one of you. for each one of you teenagers. He set the example. He said, hey, I've been through the temptations you've been through. I've been through the ridicule that you've been through. I've been laughed at like you have. I've done everything so that I could feel the pain you're feeling. And he says, and I did it so you don't have to go through it alone. And today I want to tell you, if you're having a rough life, you're having a rough teenage life, if you're having a rough young adult life, if you're having a rough senior adult life, a middle-aged life, I'm here to tell you that Jesus went through everything so that you don't have to go through it alone. So we see he had a rough start. The teen years had to be rough. I mean, I can only imagine going through the stuff that teenagers go through. Because I know we all like to think of Jesus. Jesus is just, you know, everybody back then knew, they didn't know Jesus was who we know Jesus as today. Jesus is one of the guys hanging out with them out in the you know, the fields and stuff like that. And they just think, dude, he crazy. Man, Elizabeth wanted to kiss Jesus the other day. He said, no. What is wrong with him? Elizabeth invited Jesus over to her house the other day because she really thinks he's cute and she really wants to hook up with him. But Jesus said no. Now you think about it. We snicker and we laugh about it. But Jesus was tempted, the scripture told us, in every way that we are tempted. So I'm sure Jesus thought, well, but I can't because I come for a reason. You can do it, guys. If you get serious about your faith, adults, if you get serious about your faith, if we get excited about Jesus, we can make it through the temptations. We can make it through the rough patches in our life. But a lot of you probably like me. I like people to like me. Anybody in here don't like people to like them? I didn't think so. Everybody likes to be liked. But sometimes there's a line in the sand that's made there by the Bible that says, don't cross it. And sometimes when we don't cross the line, it's not popular. And we may get laughed at. We may get ridiculed. We may get poked fun at work. We may get poked fun at school. But I want to tell you, it's worth it. You may never think it's worth it while you're here, but it'll be worth it one day when you stand before Jesus. The song we just sung a while ago, he's coming back. He's coming back. This ain't a little fairy tale. I know a lot of us have heard it, and I heard my grandparents say it. I believe he'll come back before I leave this world, but they passed on and gone because it just wasn't time yet. But I believe he's coming again. If I didn't believe he is coming again, I would say shut the doors. There's no need of us coming because he ain't coming back. The reason this old boy gets up here and tells you every Sunday that Jesus loves you, Jesus died on the cross for you, Jesus can forgive you of your sins is because I know he's coming back. And if you're not ready when he comes back, then my friend, you're in a world of hurt. You think you have a rough life now. You go over there and read Revelations where after the church is pulled out, you go ahead and read what happens in Revelations. You think you got a rough life now, it'll get real rough. But it just don't stop here. It'll be real rough for eternity. So you have a decision to make. So we see it was rough through his birth. In the beginning it was rough. It was rough through his teen years. But let's jump ahead a few years into his ministry years. When he was around 30 years of age and he come out and he started doing his ministry. And that's when we see all the Gospels talking about Jesus. And this is what the Bible says in John 1:11. He came to his own did not receive him. In Luke 4:24, Jesus said, then he said, assuredly I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. He had a rough childhood. He had a rough teen life. But then even when he got up in his young adult age, he was still not accepted. You know, a lot of people, you know, all the times you read in the scripture where they said, Jesus, we believe he's the Messiah. He's healing all these people. They wanted to take him and put him on the throne, give him a crown, and make him like a King David or a King Saul. But Jesus said, no, 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 that's not why I've come. And they hated him for that because they wanted something else. There's a lot of you here, you're having a rough life because you're wanting something else contrary to what God has in store for you. And I'm telling you, as long as you're wanting that and you're mad at God because he's not giving you what you want, I'm telling you, God didn't come to make you happy. He came to make you holy. And when we get that mindset, God don't want you to be happy. God wants you to be holy. And if you get holy, you'll be happy. That's just the way it works. But a lot of it's because things don't work out the way we want. We think our life's going rough, and God's sitting there going, man, I laid out the path for you, but you're going through the briars. No wonder you're getting stuck so much. But it's so good because when we get in the briar patch, God's got a big old sling blade, and he'll cut us a path right out of it if we want out of it. We get in a rough life, but Jesus had a rough life. He was rejected as a teenager. He was even rejected as a baby. They said, there's no room for y'all in the inn, and they seen she was pregnant. He was rejected at birth. He was rejected as a teen. He was rejected as a young adult. And we know it was rough, but then it was rough ministry years, but then we see there was a rough end. It was a rough end. Isaiah 53 verse 5 says this, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Did you notice three words in there? And I highlighted them on our PowerPoint for us. What are those three words? Our, our, our. Jesus lived the roughest life that's ever been lived. A lot of us, we like to think Jesus lived a rough life at the whipping post. We like to think he lived a rough life when he was on the cross. But it just wasn't that one or two days that he had a rough life. It was from his birth for his whole 33 years. He lived a rough life just for you, for your transgressions, for your iniquities, and for your peace. That's the reason Jesus came and lived a rough life, so that you don't have to live it alone. And so that you can go and live with him in eternity. We know that, as I was telling the kids this Wednesday night, I was telling them the story about the candy cane. And if any of you know the story of the candy cane, it's got the three stripes on it, and it's got the one big red stripe, where the three stripes represent the scourging that Jesus took at the whipping post. As he took those stripes, in our verse that we just read, it says, by his stripes you are healed. Let me tell you, my friend, if you're here this morning and you would say, preacher, I've had a rough life. Preacher, I've had a rough year. Preacher, it's been a rough week. He took the stripes so that you can be healed. This morning, I don't care how rough it is. I don't care how much you've messed up. You might be here this morning. You might be in an adulterous affair and nobody knows about it but you and God. You might be here this morning and you're having premarital sex and nobody knows about it but you and your boyfriend or your girlfriend and God, and you think everything's going to be all right. But now you realize, oh Lord, I have transgressed. I have transgressed against God, and he paid the price. I'm here to tell you that our next point is you can have a new beginning today. Because that's what happened to Jesus. He had a rough life for 33 years. He went through the depths of everything for us. But then there was a new beginning. Praise God. Amber picked out. God just orchestrates everything. That song we sung a while ago just says it all. Well, Jesus' new beginning. It says it in 1 Corinthians 15:3-4. For I delivered to you first of all, which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. But that wasn't just the end of it. That was the end of the rough part. But listen, there's good news coming. And that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. Can I tell you, the first Christmas gift that was ever open was not open on Christmas Day. It was open on the third day. And that's the reason we can stand here today, is because the greatest gift has been given. If you've messed up, it's okay. If you think you've done too much bad, it's okay. He came to forgive you. By his stripes, you can be healed. But for you to be healed, you got to go to the doctor. There's a lot of us, can a lot of men agree with me, when we get sick and our wives tell us or our mamas tell us, you need to go to the doctor. No, I'm good. I'm good. I'll be all right. Just give me a couple days. There's stuff flying out everywhere. But he said, everything's going to be all right. And we don't go to the doctor and we get worse. Let me tell you this morning, the Bible tells us that God is our great physician, and he can heal you today. He can heal you from your hurt. He can heal you from your rough life that you had. Now, is everything, when you go home, if you come to the altar and pour it all and give it to him, is everything going to change just automatically and everything be wonderful? No. I wish I could say yes. I wish I could, but I can't. But he can change how you get through it. He can change how you get through it. we see there was a great day. Because of the new beginning Christ got, when God raised him from the grave, because of his new beginning after his rough life, that paid for you to have a new beginning, if you so choose to have one. Maybe you're here today and you're a Christian and, man, life's been rough. You've got away from God and things have got kind of rough. You can have a new beginning today. You can start over. That's the thing I love about God. His forgiveness and mercy is new every day. His mercy is new every day. That mercy that you got yesterday, it's gone. But thank God there's new mercy for today. You can start over. No matter what you've done to mess up. Guys, look at me. Look at me right here. If you're middle school up or right in fifth grade and up, look at me. If you've messed up and you've done something that you just thinking to yourself right now, man, I've messed up. Nobody knows what I've done. God knows, and he loves you, and he wants to forgive you today. He died on the cross to forgive you. You just got to come to the doctor. You just got to come to the doctor. All my adults, look at me real quick. I don't know what it is in your life, but I know this old boy stumbles and falls and fails every day. When's the last time you really sought God and asked for forgiveness and asked him to cleanse you and make you whole and give you a new beginning? Today can be the day. Today can be the day of a new beginning. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. Let me hear you, my friend. There's a lot of people in here today that I don't know. There's a lot of people in here I do know. But the one thing I don't know anyone in here's soul's condition besides my own. I can say there's a lot of people in here that I think is a good Christian person. I think they're saved, and I think they will go to heaven. But I don't know that. And you don't know that about me. All you know is about you. I want to ask every person in this room today, if you died today, I don't care how old you are, how young you are, there's no promise of tomorrow. If you died today, if something tragic happened and you passed and went into eternity, where would you spend it? There's only one or two places you'll spend eternity, heaven or hell. That's just truth. If you would say, I've never truly received Christ, I've been playing the Christian game, I've never truly received him as my Savior, let me tell you, I don't care how good a person you are. I don't care how many times you come to church. I don't care if your role's on the church. I don't care if your role's on four churches. You will still die and go to hell without Jesus. So today, you can have the new beginning that 2 Corinthians 5:17 talks about. You can become a new person today, but you have to choose to. As Amber comes, or as the band comes, or whoever's doing the invitation, we're going to have communion here in just a moment. But this is the second part of my invitation. First part of my invitation is, if you have never received Christ as your Savior, let me tell you, you want to have the best Christmas that you've ever had? Meet the one that we celebrate, and you'll have the best Christmas that you ever have. I beg you this morning, come to the doctor. Come to the great physician. Don't let pride send you to hell. Don't let people stand around you. Don't worry about what anybody's doing. Just focus on God for a moment. But the second part of my invitation is this. Like I said, as soon as we get done with the invitation, we're going to partake in communion. But there's one very important thing you need to know about communion. If you're not ready to partake of communion spiritually, it's not a good thing. And that's not just a preacher saying. Let me give you the scripture. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:27-29. I'm going to read it straight out of the Bible so you see it coming straight from the Word of God. Verses 27-29 say this, therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats, listen to this. This is important. I don't know why me preachers don't drive this home, because this is so important. This could change your life. What you do with this little cup today could change your life. Listen to me. This is what the Word of God says. If you partake of this, unworthily. And that's talking about if you've got some sin in your life, if you're not living right, you got some stuff that you need to confess before God, and you partake of this, listen, what will happen? It says, for he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. The King James says, you'll bring damnation upon yourself. And a lot of us wonder why we live in a rough life. A lot of us have brought it on ourselves because we don't follow what God's Word has told us. So, second part of my invitation, before we partake of communion this morning, I'm going to beg you, friend, examine yourself. Examine yourself. Is there something you need to get rid of before we partake and remember what Christ has done for us this morning? I beg you, come to the altar right where you're at, somewhere. You ain't got to do it for this old boy. You do it for yourself because you need to get right with God. But if you're here this morning and you're lost, I'm begging you, friend. I don't care if you joined the church a month ago or if you joined the church 10 years ago. It ain't worth your eternity for your pride. I beg you, come. This is the one thing I say it every Sunday. Be obedient to what God is telling you to do today. And then after the invitation is over, we're going to sit and we're going to partake of communion together as a family and celebrate what Christ has done. But don't do it if you're not ready. Come to the doctor this morning. Father, we love you. And God, I just pray that in this moment that your Holy Spirit, oh God, I pray that you would... I pray that you move. God, I know that you will. I know that you're moving. I know that you're going from heart to heart. But God, I pray, Lord, that you would give these people and myself, God, give us ears to hear today. But not only let us hear what you're telling us, let us obey. Oh, Father, what would happen in this day if we all got on our face before you, repented of our sins, God, and got in just the right relationship with you today? God, I can't even imagine what you would do in this place if we would all just be obedient. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would just move. Lord, if there's one here that's lost, I pray, God, they would come and take me by the hand and say, I need Jesus, God, and I'll show them through your word how that they can receive you today. I just want to add this to it, just because I don't never do it, and I want to make sure everybody has an opportunity. If you're in the sound booth, if you're in the band and you're playing and you need to get it right with Jesus today, hey, we can do this without any music. We can do this without anything. The most important thing is every person in this room gets an opportunity to get right with Jesus this morning. So I don't care what you're doing. You just drop it, leave it there. It'll be okay. I promise you. I'd rather everything, the lights go off and everything just fall apart if one person just gets right with Jesus. So I just want to open that up. Anybody in this room, this is for everybody that's serving us, that serves us every Sunday. We're going to take a communion, but are you going to be ready? Father, we pray this in the name of Jesus. Move. Let us not be afraid. Let us be bold and step out for you. And we ask this in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. As we all stand together, you do what God has told you to do while you were sitting there. Don't wait. Get up and do it. Let's worship together.
Earth has no sorrow. Earth has
just be real for just a minute. One thing you find out, Jordan asked me the other day to send him three questions or three sentences that he'd want me to describe liberty. And I said, the three things that I want liberty to be, I want it to be a place where people can come and feel loved. I want it to be a place where people can come and be real. I don't want us to put on a show. I don't want us to be something we're not. That's why you see me every day and you think, what in the world is he wearing today? Because I just want you to be real. This is who I am. I'm not trying to put on a show and be somebody special because I'm nobody special. And I want it to be a place where people can feel that they belong. But with a crowd this size, I want to be real for just a minute. A crowd this size, I just gave you the scripture. And this is between you and the Lord. This ain't got nothing to do with me. I'm just looking out for your best interest. I just gave you the scripture that says, if you partake of this, this ain't nothing special. It's just a little wafer and some juice. But if you partake of it, the Bible says, and you do it in remembrance of me, and you do it unworthily, you are hurting yourself. In a crowd this size, we're going to partake of it in a minute. I'm just giving you one last chance to get it right. Not for me, because I have to stand before God one day for what I do with this, so do you for yourself. So as we sing one more verse, I want to beg you, friend. I want you to do one or two things. You either get it right before you partake, or when we pass the basket in a minute for you to take one out, just let it pass. I'd rather you not partake than if you partake and something bad happens to you. Choice is yours. I'd rather you get it right with God and start a new beginning today. But as always, it's up to you. It's up to you. Let's sing one more verse. These are still praying. We're never going to rush anybody out of the altar. As long as they want to pray, we'll stay here all day and pray down heaven. But they're giving you an opportunity to come. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that your spirit right now, Lord, that you would break strongholds. God, I pray, Lord, that whatever's holding somebody back this morning, God, that Satan's got them bound up, I pray that right now that you would break the chains. God, that you would drop those shackles. Father, I pray that they would feel you setting them free so that you can come and be healed. God, you told us you've took the stripes. The price is paid. All they got to do is come and receive. Lord, I pray in this moment, God, let them be bold. Let them not be afraid. Lord, let them come running to you this morning. Father, I pray that when I say amen, that one or two or 50 people that's in this room that you're telling, you better get it right. I pray that when I say amen, they let go of the pew. They let go of that hand beside them. Maybe they drag somebody with them, but they would come and be obedient to you. Father, move in this place. In the name of Jesus, amen. Move if you need to move this morning. Move if you need to move. As we sing one more verse, and then we'll partake.
There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table. Come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary. Rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can cure. So lay down, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, under
living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified, freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day. Living, He loved me, and dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away.
Has everyone been served? Everyone's been served. I want us to take just a moment, just in your mind. Everyone just close your eyes for just a moment. And I just want you to picture Jesus tied to that whipping post and the stripes that he took that day just for you. The stripes that he took that day just for you. Father, I pray, Lord, as we partake of this Holy Communion, and God, as we remember the stripes that your body took that day, God, that you took just for us. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would just, in this moment, remind us of how much you love us as we partake. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, if you'll take the first little wrapper off and get your bread out. Give everybody just a second to get it out. Amen. Amen. This is what the Bible says. It says, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Amen and amen. Now let's go back for just a moment, and remember the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. As he was sitting there, just picture in your mind, as he laid his life down. It said they didn't have to hold him down. He laid his life down. And they drove the nail through his left hand. They drove the nail through his right hand. They drove the nail through his feet. And they hung him on the cross. And there the Bible tells us that his blood was shed out just for you. As we remember that this morning, Father, we thank you for your body. But we thank you for the blood that covers our sins. And Father, I pray this morning that this would be a special time in our life, that we would truly remember what you've done for us. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. And the Bible says, in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. If you want to, you can just take your cup and put it in the little cup holders in front of you. We'll get those later. Church, I just want to say what a special day that today has been. We've seen a soul get saved from death to life. What we just done, what it's all about, the reason we can partake is because of that day that happened in our life. Praise God. What a Christmas for that family. What a Christmas for that family. We had a new person come and join our family this morning. Amen. Can we just celebrate all that God's done today? I'm telling you, he's worthy. He's worthy. And let me tell you, I am so excited about 2016 and what God's going to do, not just in this place, but through this place. As we go, like I said, I'm excited about next week. Come, I'm going to throw some vision next week. We're going to kind of get us dig in. We got something really special that we're going to start next week. So I beg you, if you can be here, if you got vacations to go to Disney World, cancel them and be here Sunday. You can watch it. If you're going to Disney World, you can go and we'll make sure we get it on YouTube and you can watch it, okay? If you go into Disney World. But if you're not going to Disney World, be here next Sunday. It's going to be special. And like I said, be preparing for our 2016 fast. We'll start that the first Sunday in January. Like I said, consult your physician about what you can partake. You know, the Daniel fast, just in case you don't know what the Daniel fast is, the Daniel fast is 21 days of just water, beans, and fruit. It's not a full fast where you're not eating anything. You can eat beans and fruit and drink water. So be getting prepared for that. That gives you 2 weeks to do your grocery shopping to get ready. And like I said, we'd love for you to join that. Next week I'm going to give you some things I want you to be praying about during that fast. And then also be thinking about what you want to be praying about in your personal life for that fast. And I believe if we start off the year truly seeking God, we think what we've seen the past few months is great. Better is yet to come. Amen. I love you, church. From my family to your family, I want to say we love you. And I want to say Merry Christmas. And I hope that each and every one of you have the best Christmas this year. And I'm not talking about a pile of gifts. I'm talking about I hope you feel the love of Jesus with your family this Christmas. So, church, I love you. Thank you so much for coming. Like I said, the next two Wednesday nights, we're taking them off. Give our workers a little break for a couple weeks while the kids are out of school to let you celebrate with your families and just give everybody just a breather so we can jump right back in the first week of January and go 100 miles per hour, put that baby in fifth gear, and push the pedal to the floor. So if y'all ain't know me by yet, I'm a go-go-go kind of guy. So we're going to push the pedal to the floor in 2016. So let me pray for you, and then you'll be dismissed to go. All right? Father, we love you. We praise your holy name for what you did this morning. God, no man can take credit for what you've done in this place. God, for the new beginnings that you began today, for the restoration that you had, Lord, for the salvation that we sing. God, we praise your holy name. God, you are worthy. I'm so thankful that you still save souls. God, I pray if there's one person in this building that they needed to come, that before they turn and walk out that door, God, that they would turn and come to you this morning. God, this altar is never closed. Father, I pray for each of person that's here, Lord, for the few families that couldn't be with us today. God, I pray a special blessing that this Christmas, Lord, that you would just, Lord, they would truly remember the real reason, and may we celebrate nothing else but you. Father, we love you and we praise you, and we just ask that 2016 would be a year for you at Liberty Baptist Church. Father, we love you, praise you, and we ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Love you, church. We'll see y'all next.